In this video, we are going to discuss various pros and cons of this technique. Let's take a look at the pros of restriction enzyme cloning, which are summarized on this slide. Perhaps the greatest pro to restriction enzyme cloning is that it is conceptually simple. The idea of cutting and religating DNA fragments simply sounds easy. In that context, this idea of cutting and pasting resonates with the important molecular biology concept of modularity. There are many types of functional elements in molecular biology. Some of these functional elements are in DNA and genes. For instance, a gene may require a promoter, a coding sequence, and a 3' untranslated region. We have learned that these elements can be swapped around much like Lego bricks. Restriction enzymes were the first tools used in the lab that allowed us to move pieces of DNA in this manner. Restriction enzyme cloning is distinct from most other cloning methods in that it reproducibly makes copies of your gene of interest while introducing the least mutation. As we will see with other cloning techniques, they are all partially or completely dependent on the use of PCR products. The purified enzymes for PCR have significantly higher mutation rates than that of the intact in vivo replication machinery of E. coli. Even the highest fidelity PCR enzymes introduce errors at 100 to 1,000 times the rate of E. coli. These next three bullet points are related. Restriction enzyme cloning has been around a long time. As a result, a great repository of reagents have been developed. For instance, the nonprofit AdGene distributes over 90,000 plasmids from over 4,000 labs, and there are untold numbers of clones in the literature that have not been submitted to AdGene. Restriction cloning does not require specialized equipment, and along with the abundant clones and vectors available, most common restriction enzymes have become quite inexpensive to purchase. So why the asterisk? While the reagents can be inexpensive, time is costly. And this brings us to the challenges associated with restriction enzyme cloning. As a general rule, ligations are tricky. Ratios need to be accurate. Ends need to be intact. You need good ligase activity and ATP that has not been degraded. When it works, great. But if you need to troubleshoot, it takes time. In addition to this general observation, there are some concrete challenges we will review associated with restriction cloning. The first potential problem with restriction cloning is the dependence on restriction sites. You may remember from your intro courses that any particular six-cutter restriction site will be found once every 4,000 base pairs on average. In order to successfully perform directional cloning, you need to find two restriction sites flanking your fragment of interest that will allow you to insert your fragment into the vector that matches the goals of your experiment. Not only must you find these sites, they must put the insert into the vector in the correct orientation. Finally, neither enzyme can cut anywhere else in the vector. With a simple 3,000 base pair vector, this is not usually a problem, but as you add additional fragments of DNA to the vector, you are adding more sites. Let's go back and take another look at the multi-cloning site of PUC19. In our simple example, we dropped a GFP fragment into this multi-cloning site using the restriction enzymes, PST1 and BAMH1. The consequences of this are twofold. First, we have lost the part of the multi-cloning site located between these two enzyme sites, which includes four other restriction cloning sites. Secondly, the 717 base pair fragment we inserted has its own associated restriction sites, a subset of which are shown here. So subsequent cloning strategies into this construct need to take these changes into account. It is not uncommon to find a plasmid vector that started with an intact multi-cloning site, but after several fragments were added through different combinations of restriction enzyme sites in the multi-cloning site, the multi-cloning site has been obliterated, making it difficult to make additional changes to the vector if you rely only on restriction enzyme cloning. An important tangent to this is that when we are talking about cloning coding sequences into plasmids and would like the protein to be expressed, we need to be sure that the inserted product maintains the correct translational reading frame. This is not a given outcome with restriction cloning and frequently limits enzyme choices. it is difficult to get multiple fragments to ligate successfully. In the SnapGene restriction cloning tool, you can see the option to ligate multiple fragments together, in fact, up to 10. While this is easy to do in silico, ligation efficiencies drop precipitously as you try to ligate multiple fragments together at the same time. Getting 3 fragments to ligate efficiently in the same reaction is rare. 4 fragments is cause for well-deserved bragging. As we will see in upcoming videos, other techniques are available that are much more efficient at recombining multiple fragments at the same time. There are idiosyncratic challenges associated with certain enzymes. Some have short half-lives, others are prone to star activity. In this gel, copied from Thermo Fisher, we can see examples of both incomplete, inefficient cleavage, as well as star activity. In lane 1, we see our plasmid has been linearized. In lane 4, we can see what our plasmid looks like if it has been digested to completion, in this case, 5 discrete bands. Lanes 2 and 3 show different degrees of partial cleavage. In lane 3, and less so in lane 2, we can still make out the products of complete cleavage, but progressively see more intermediate-sized fragments. Lanes 5 and 6 show an example of star activity. As we described earlier, star activity is a loss of specificity. But you can see it is not fully random either, with many extra bands indicating a cleavage away from the enzyme's cognate recognition sequence. Not detectable on this type of gel would be star activity that is simply the nibbling of the generated ends, decreasing the ability of your ends to overlap efficiently in your ligation reaction. So, how do you deal with incomplete digestion or star activity? In the case of incomplete digestion, you allow the digest to run longer or add more enzyme. Refer to the manufacturer literature, as this is not always a simple choice. Some enzymes are stable for several hours, so extending the time of your reaction incubation is sufficient to improve the outcome. Other enzymes lose activity within a few hours. If this is the case with your enzyme, adding more at the start will not be helpful. Instead, you will need to add additional fresh enzyme midway through the reaction. To deal with star activity, double check that you are using the correct reaction buffer and have given it time to fully thaw and be resuspended. Be sure you have diluted it correctly. Sometimes star activity develops when the reaction runs too long, so pay attention to the timing of your digest. Another restriction enzyme idiosyncrasy to be aware of is that most enzymes require a few nucleotides outside of their recognition sequence in order to stably attach to DNA. Here is some sample data about 2 enzymes to illustrate this point. In the first example, ASC1, which has an 8 base pair recognition sequence, you can see there is over 90% digestion of the indicated oligonucleotide whether or not extra bases flank the restriction site. In contrast, with the example NDE1, you do not see efficient cleavage unless there are 7 bases on either side of the recognition sequence. The second example is more typical of most restriction enzymes. The need for sufficient flanking DNA can actually become a problem if you are cutting in a multi-cloning site and the recognition sites of the enzymes you have chosen or wish to use overlap or are immediately adjacent to each other. All of the enzyme idiosyncrasies are well documented and available from the enzyme manufacturers. The final problem that can result from restriction cloning is that sometimes you are forced to incorporate extraneous DNA sequence in your clone. Needless to say, many great experiments have succeeded over the years even if they carried extraneous sequence, aka scars, but it is not ideal. Let's examine the source of scars. First, let's go back to our PUC19 multi-cloning site, into which we have cloned a GFP fragment between the PST1 and the BAMH1 sites. Now, let's say we want to put a second fragment into this vector, this time using KPN1 and ECOR1. The sequence between the 2 fragments that we cloned is extraneous to our experiment. Another source of extraneous DNA that can be incorporated in your clone simply results from the location of your selected restriction enzyme. If you need to clone with SAL1 and the closest SAL1 site is 20 base pairs away from the region you're interested in, you'll be forced to include this extraneous material in your clone. Let's recap the pros and cons of restriction cloning. Restriction cloning is conceptually as simple as cut and paste. Because it has been around for such a long time, an expanded arsenal of vectors exist. Any one of these might only need a modest change to produce the clone you need for your experiment. In general, the reagents used in restriction cloning are inexpensive, and there is no need for specialized equipment. We have also discussed the challenges associated with basic restriction cloning. Restriction cloning is not flexible. You need to find sites that are convenient for your cloning project. As a result, there are now over 600 commercially available restriction enzymes. Not all enzymes work with equal efficiency. Some enzymes are simply more finicky than others and prone to incomplete digests or star activity. Because we are dependent on the location of restriction sites relative to the fragments we are cloning, extraneous sequences are often carried along in constructs. In addition, many cloning projects require incorporation of multiple fragments to create the desired construct. This can take considerable time when using restriction cloning. The challenges and limitations of restriction cloning have driven the creation of several other cloning techniques that we will discuss in other videos. To learn more about molecular cloning, visit snapgene.com.